Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning, Lord. We have rejoicing in the camp, Father. We praise you for all of the miracles, Lord, that you are doing in each of our lives, Heavenly Father. Lord, we thank you for holding on to us in the middle of the storm, and that storms don't last forever. And Lord, we thank you that you are the one, Father, that lets the sun shine through, and we move on, and we thank you, Lord, for the answers to prayer in all of our lives this morning. In Jesus' name, we all said, amen. Well, it's great to see you all. We're going to be in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. Last week, we read about how the Lord will help us climb upon our high hills. How the Lord, we will be like those little goats or whatever they were, little deers, and he will make our feet like hinds' feet, that we can climb upon those hard places in our lives, and that when we get on the top of that mountain, as we've leaned into the rock and stayed as close to the rock as we possibly can, as we get up to the top of that mountain, we'll be dancing. We'll be having a good time. We will skip upon the hard times in our lives. And that is the power of the Lord Jesus Christ, that no matter what this life holds for you, the Lord will give you the power to endure, and not only endure, but you will become victorious and it will not destroy you. Can I get everyone to say amen?
Amen.
It will not destroy you. Anything formed against you that touches you touches the apple of God's eye, and it will not destroy you. Those are what the words we studied last week were. And here we see Paul with this baby church. His heart is still drawn to them, even though now he's in Athens. He's been to Corinth. He is traveling all around. His heart is heavy for this church that he has started there. And we know that this town of Thessalonica was a seaport village. And we know that once they seen the church growing, that they rose up against them, that they went ahead and Paul had to flee during the night. And so here we see that Paul had even sent back Timothy to encourage them because they were his baby. And we talked about that with our church, with the churches we've started. We literally feel like those are our babies. And so when Gerald and I go to Idaho, we always meet up with the Yost, and we always meet up with now Dave Rose, and we always meet up with anyone starting a church. And then we try to encourage Chris and Lydia. Those are our babies. Those are the ones this church is helping go forward to raise many people for the Lord Jesus Christ. And what's amazing now is every single church stands financially completely on their own. Only God can do that in an area that is 90% Mormon. These places that we've gone are hard places to start a church in. Rupert, Idaho is a closed-knit LDS community. Gooding is a small area that is probably 90% LDS. And Tooele, Utah is the same way. And here they launch out to places that a lot of people would never consider. That God would lay on our heart the calling he has for us. And this is what that he's going to be talking about today. We also know that in any time you're going forward, the battle can get harder. Anytime you're gaining ground for the kingdom of God, the enemy is going to be right at your heels, nipping and nipping and nipping. And with that, sometimes can come weariness. Paul is going to be addressing this because this church is pretty much on their own. Timothy's reporting back what's going on, but they don't have Paul there all the time. And Paul only got to be there for a short 3 weeks before he had to go out. It can be at times in your life a long road of difficulty, but the Lord never leaves you comfortless. The Bible says he will not leave you comfortless. He will come to you. And you have to remember that behind your pain, behind your difficulties, as it says in Ephesians 6, there is a host of wickedness that is trying to pull you down. Therefore, put on the whole armor of God that you're able to stand. We are to be those ones to look beyond the person that is attacking us, beyond the person that's discouraging us, and see it's the enemy coming through them to destroy you. It's not that person. It's the spirit of that person that is coming against you. It's not against people. It's a force of evil. We're going to read about a force of evil that happened in this church in Thessalonica. Chapter 2, verse 1 of Thessalonians 2. Now, sisters, brethren, coming of the Lord Jesus Christ and the gathering together to him, we ask you. And I want to stop right there because I heard someone's phone. Would you all just reach in right now and shut your phone off? I love my little reminders because sometimes I forget to say that. And every now and then I'll get a little phone call or it'll be something. My phone's even lit up over there and I'm thinking, that would be mine. So please turn off your phone. Concerning the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ and the gathering together is what he's talking about. The word, the rapture, is never mentioned in the Bible. It's called the gathering. Okay, so this is the word I'm going to use, and this is the word the Hebrew and the Greek use. It's called the gathering. I like that better. The Lord's going to gather us all together in the clouds, and we are going to meet with the Lord. Thank you. Let there be, and there was. That's much better. That's how it looks in here in the evening when we teach. Okay, and that the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, the gathering together of him, we ask you not to be soon shaken in your mind and troubled, neither in spirit by the word or by letter, as it is from us, as though the day of Christ had already come. There was a rumor. Oh my gosh. I'm so glad there's never any rumors in church, aren't you? Seems there's nothing new when it comes to rumors. There's nothing new under the sun. And there was a rumor started that Jesus had already came, that the return of the Messiah had happened, and they missed it. Now, keep in mind, this is a brand new church. And they're going, I don't think we missed it. And then there's always someone else going, we probably did. You know, have you ever heard of a negative Nelly? It's not our beautiful Nellie Hamlet, but a negative Nellie that's always going, well, it probably did happen. And look, that's why we're going to all these problems. And it happened. This statement came from somebody spouting off a rumor. Sometimes rumors come in the most amazing forms. And this person could have been praying. This person could have had a word of knowledge and said, and then when I came and I missed you, who knows what they were dealing with? But these dear saints in this church were dealing with a rumor that they got left behind. How many of you have ever tried to call everybody you possibly know in the whole world and they're not home and you think you got left? Raise your hand. I let that happen. And it's interesting who you call first, okay? Because you know if they answer, you're okay. You can breathe. Jesus didn't come because if anyone's going, it's her. But you call that one, and 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 no one's answering, and no one's picking up, and it's kind of a slow day in the traffic, and all of a sudden you're kind of going, well, wouldn't that just be horrible? Wouldn't that be horrible? Because we're going to talk about it. Verse 3, let no one deceive you by any means. Have that underlined. No one deceive you by any means. No one deceive you by any means. Women, we are called to be smart and alert and awake. Let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will come. It will not come unless there's a falling away first, and the man of sin will be revealed as the son of perdition. There will be a great falling away in the church, in our society, and nothing can come until that day happens. Paul is telling them here, it hasn't happened, and there are many steps that have to take place before the coming of the Lord. who oppose and exalts himself over all that is called God or that is worshiped, so that he will sit on the throne in the temple of God, showing himself that he will be God. First, there will be the gathering. You will not miss it. All right? The trumpet's going to sound, and you're going to fly away, and you're going to be up there, and we're going to be looking at everybody. The trumpet of God will sound, and ladies, we've never been closer to the gathering of the saints, and you are right now. You have never been closer to gathering with God in the clouds than right now. We might not even make it to lunch. That's how you have to live. It's going to happen. We are closer to our salvation right now than we have ever been. And so the gathering will come. And then we're going to have the down here on the earth 7 years of tribulation. Anyone who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God, there is an Antichrist coming. Flip back over here with me to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 15. We say to you by the word of the Lord that we who are alive and will remain in the coming of the Lord will by no means precede those who are asleep. For the Lord will descend from heaven with a shout and the voice of an archangel and the trump of God, and those in dead will rise first. There will be signs, there will be shouts, there will be trumpets. You will not miss the gathering. Let that just be a comfort to you right now. I don't care if you call seven people and they're not at home, you didn't miss it. My husband, his grandma, when she was dying, he went over and he said, "Grandma, do you know that you're going to go to heaven?" And I've told you before, and she said, "I hope so." Sunday school teacher in the Methodist church for 40 years. I hope so. If you have confessed that the Lord Jesus is the Son of God and you believe in your heart that he died and he rose again for you, heaven is yours. And he is coming back for his saints at any moment. What we are seeing now is the plan starting to unfold somewhat. We're seeing evil on the rise, and I'm thinking that we really do need to have somebody that was going to step up and speak peace to the entire world. And when this Antichrist comes, this Antichrist will probably abolish all religion, and it will be against the law to speak of religion. And here we see, he who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God, or all that is worshiped, he will be the one saying from here on out, all of the divisions and the problems and the fights of the century have happened because of religion. And what we need to do is abolish religion. And this is what's going to be happening when you're not here. Do a little happy dance. You are not here. The gathering has happened. We are in heaven with the Lord, and all of the good is removed from the earth. Can you even imagine? Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us. Above us only sky. This is a prelude to the Antichrist. Imagine there's no religion. Well, John Lennon, what do you think about that now? Uh-oh. Don't want anyone living in uh-oh. There is a hell. Uh-oh. Jesus was the Son of God. We see the Antichrist is going to come, and he's going to be a wise, peaceful, political leader. And he does signs and he does wonders. And everybody loves him. And let's read on. Verse 5. Do you not remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? Recall the truth that he had just told them in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 15. Paul is going, don't you remember? I taught you this. Don't be carried away. Don't be deceived. Don't think that the Lord is going to come and leave you. I've taught you this. Fall back to what you know. We talked about that last week. When you're in a trial and you are literally fighting for your life in the spiritual realm, fall back to what you know, and that is Christ is the Lord. He is supreme. He will never leave you nor forsake you. You do not need the latest new book. Fall back to what you know, and that is the scripture, and that is the word of God. And this is what Paul's telling them. Don't you remember what I have told you before? How quickly you have forgotten and have listened to a rumor. When you hear that there is a healer that's going to rise up somewhere and he's doing miraculous things, not everybody that does something miraculous is a Christian. There is an underworld. There is a copycat. And so you need to know that if it's not proclaiming the word of Jesus Christ and adhering to the word of God, it is not from God. And here we see that he is reminding them, verse 6, and you know that what is restraining, that he may be revealed from his very own time. And now you know what is restraining him. Christ is restraining the Antichrist, and the Christ in you is allowing righteousness still to be on the earth, and you are part of that restraining. Your prayers, you praying for others. We are the Christ here on earth, reaching out the love to the people that don't know the Lord, and we are part of that restraining heavenly host that is keeping the Antichrist at bay until every last person is supposed to come to know the Lord Jesus Christ comes, and then we're gone. I like what Jenny says, what our missionary, Lorna's daughter. You know, maybe she's going to be the one to reach the last one in the deepest part of India that hasn't even got a dialect to explain, and they have to explain it out in their hands that Jesus died for them. And that person's going to accept the Lord, and then we're gone. But everybody that is going to be going is called to be going, and the Lord is going to give them that direct flight just with us in heaven. But who knows who that is? What if it's that little five-year-old in Sunday school? And she says a sinner's prayer for the first time. She asks Jesus in her heart. We're gone. We don't know who that is, but we are the ones keeping the righteousness of Christ at bay in our world. And ladies, you need to let your light shine. This is never, and it looks like you are. I must say, you're filling this place up. But this is the time where we shine for Christ. This is the time where we go forward for the Lord. This is not the time to crawl back. It says here, and now you know what is restraining, that he will be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of the lawless one is already at work. The Antichrist is already at work. What is an Antichrist? It is the spirit of anyone that is not serving the Lord Jesus Christ. It rises itself up against God. They can't even, and you know what's really scary is you need to make sure that that doesn't rise up in you. Well, how could that ever rise up in me? I'm a born-again Christian. Ever had a horrible day? Ever seen an anger in you that scares you to death? And you have to go into bed at night and get on your knees and say, forgive me? Because I just said something really cruel to somebody. Do you ever think that the Antichrist could rise up in you, that spirit that comes against God? You ever seen a pastor wash out? It's the spirit of Antichrist that wars against our soul, which is our enemy. That is our enemy. But ladies, we don't give in to that. Greater is he that is in you than he that's out here in the world talking to you and trying to discourage you. And it says here, this is the mystery of the lawless one that is already at work. Only he knows how to restrain, and he will do so until he is taken out of the way. The mystery of the lawless one is already working, and he was working back then 2,000 years ago. That's why we have Ephesians 6 to remind us to put on the whole armor of Christ. Verse 8, and then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his very coming. It's interesting when they're talking about the Antichrist will be revealed, and it talks about he is coming up on the stage. Everything the Antichrist is going to do will be a copycat of Christ, but he will be evil. And here the real Lord Jesus will come and destroy him with his brightness. Ladies, you have a bright future ahead. You have a bright future ahead of you. The Lord knows what he's doing in your life, and the Lord knows your heart. Thank God the Lord knows my heart, because it got kind of weird there about a week ago. You know, I, those of you know that I went in and there was something pressure in my heart. I go into the doctor, and seriously, my doctor is just a really nice guy, but he looks like he's 12. And he looks at me and he says, "You must hurry and get over to the emergency room." Well, poor Gerald, it kind of gave him a heart attack because he's thinking, "I'm going to die on the way to the emergency room." And then we get there and the cardiologist that's more my age looks and says, "You're fine, but now that we got you, we're going to run a bunch of tests and keep you overnight." So I said, "No, I don't think so." And we had a little argument there in the ER room that I didn't want to stay, and he said you would stay, and this is going on. So finally, an administrator comes into the room, and I'm sitting there with Gerald, and I'm wanting to leave now because my heart's good, got a good heart. And she said, "I have to tell you that if you choose to leave now, your insurance will not cover you because we're not releasing you, and you're going to go out as a missing in action patient. And we won't cover you unless you stay." Okay, I'll stay. Because it was very expensive. The Lord knows your heart. The Lord knows everything about you. And we studied whoever touches you touches the apple of God's eye. How much is he going to help you get through this part of your journey? But ladies, it's a very scary thing that when somebody can come to know the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior or hear about the Lord, that they harden their heart and they walk away. And we're seeing that happen daily in the church, not this church, but other churches, where people are hardening their hearts and walking away from Christianity. And it says here that he is going to come and deceive many. I like what it says in verse 10. It says, "With all the unrighteousness and the deception among those who are going to perish, because they did not receive the love of truth that they could be saved." We speak love. We have the most wonderful story to tell. We can't even mask it in the word religion. We have a story to tell. And it is the most beautiful story about a loving God that comes down and reaches us and becomes an ant so he can relate to the ant to show them the way that they can have salvation. We have a story to tell. Everything else is religion. But once you hear that story, it has power in it. It is life-changing. Look at all of you sitting here. Your lives are not the same once you heard that story of Jesus Christ. But then there's those that have heard the story and don't get plugged in, are letting people deceive them, and they will choose to believe a lie rather than embrace Jesus Christ. But I want to tell you, when people leave the love of the truth, they will go and find a religion that will be mean to them. What? Yes. When people leave the love of the truth of Jesus Christ and the story that we tell to the nations and embrace another religion, it is always for their harm. Because religion without the blood of Jesus Christ is cruel and man-made. And it will expect very high demands on you when you leave the blood and the love of Jesus Christ. If you join one church, they will tell you you have to join their church and that you have to adhere to somebody and tell your sins to a box. And then this man sits behind the box because he's so spiritual. And he says, I forgive you. La-ti-da. Then there's another one, which I happen to know much about this one. But they will tell you if you join our church, you will become a god. And if you have enough spirit babies that are happening up there with God and Mary, and you give birth to all these little spirit babies, eventually you will have your own planet. And you will be God of the planet like Jesus was God of the planet Earth. Well, la-ti-da. Then there's another one that says if you contemplate spirituality enough and you gain energy from all of these minerals in the world, that you will be wise. And it goes on, and they will put heavy burdens on you. They will tell you you have to perform this. You have to look like that. You have to wear this. And I've got a video to show you the scariest one that's happening right now. So if I can get Dory to turn off the lights and I can get Dylan to play this video. This is our new scary religion that is indoctrinating women that have left the truth of Jesus Christ. American girls that have probably been raised in the church, turning their backs on what they have learned and going to join militants. But what about the ones that were raised in the church that turn their back and go out just to be worldly or just to walk away from the Lord? And then the enemy comes and makes their life just a big mess and they have to get out of drugs or maybe alcohol. Who knows? Once you walk away from the love of our story, you will put heavy burdens upon your heart. You were made to have the Creator grow in you. And as you grow, He grows with you and He gets you through life, through everything. But it says here, verse 8, the lawless one will be revealed, of whom the Lord will consume with His breath and His mouth and destroy them with the brightness. And the coming of the lawless one according to the working of Satan and all the power and signs and lying wonders with all the unrighteous deception. Have that underlined. That's what people that turn from the love of the Lord, they follow unrighteous deception among those who perish. They will be part left here when Jesus comes. They will not go in the rapture because they chose unrighteous deception. They will be left here to perish, is what the Bible says. They did because they did not receive, and I have this underlined over and over again, the love of the truth. The love of the truth. You don't just like it, like you hit like on Facebook, I like. You love the truth. Because they did not receive the love of the truth that they could be saved. It is so easy to accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. But they chose not to want the love. Have you ever had somebody choose not to want love? It's devastating that they would choose something other than love. A strong delusion. And here are these ones that maybe have been raised in the church, the Westerners that are coming out, are looking over here and going, I want to go try that. And the enemy is heavy at work. And this is our new religion. So I'm not even going to group Christianity in with religion. It's our story we have to tell. It has nothing to do with religion. It has to do with the wonderful Lord Jesus Christ who desires a relationship with you. Verse 11, it says, and for this reason, God will send them into a strong delusion that they should not believe, that they will believe a lie. It's a dangerous thing to walk away from the love of the Lord. Because the Bible says when you walk away from the love, a delusion comes and you can't think right anymore. That's what being backslidden, being a Christian that's not walking with the Lord, is close to insanity. Because deep down they know what's right and they're buying this instead. And it gnaws at them and it bothers them. And they're most of the times the most belligerent people out there is a backslidden Christian. For this reason, they will believe a strong delusion. When the good is taken out of the world, and saints, that is you, because what's good in you is Christ. When we're taken out of the world, the whole world is going to believe a strong delusion. And it's going to be a lie. And it's going to be the end of the world. And we won't be here, thank the Lord. We look at this and go, how much worse can it get? Tons. Much more pain. We are the salt of the earth, the Lord says. But if we lose our flavor, what good are we? What causes you to lose your flavor? The weariness of your heart. When you're weary, you are not producing for the kingdom because you're tired. And that's why we need that constant renewal of the Lord Jesus Christ in our life. And you have to fight for your time alone with Him. That is where you're renewed and you mount up like with wings of eagles. And then you can run again. And you can go out and you can be refreshed and you can be salty and entice someone else to come and see and go and tell what Jesus has done. This reason they will send them a strong delusion that they will believe a lie. And they will be condemned, those who did not believe, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Can you think of some things we've seen on TV that have pleasures in unrighteousness? They delight in blood and killing someone. Have you known somebody that's delighted in bringing you pain? It says here that they will be condemned, those who did not believe what? The truth. They didn't believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. And then I'm going to read this to you, and it says, but we're bound to give thanks to the Lord always for you, sisters, beloved in the Lord, because God from the beginning chose you for salvation. I have that underlined. God from the beginning chose you for salvation through the sanctification of the Spirit and the belief of the truth, to which he called you by the gospel and obtaining glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, stand fast. Hold on. And hold tight to the traditions which you were taught. Hold tight to what you know, and that is that the Lord Jesus Christ loves you. You are his child. You are a daughter of the King. Hold tight to what you know. Hold still. Don't let anybody deceive you. Hold to the traditions that you were taught, whether by word or by this epistle. And now may the Lord Jesus Christ himself, the Father God, who has loved us and given us this consolation of good hope and grace, comfort your heart, establish you in every good work. I'm going to read to you, because when I was studying, I always read the Hebrew along with the Bible, and I was reading this chapter, and I just loved how the Hebrew text words it. But I want you to understand that exercising your faith and practicing love will give you perseverance to get through your life. Exercising your faith in God, you're going to practice love. Do you know what practice means? Over and over and over and over and over and over again. When I was a little girl, my mom had me play the piano. I hated it. Hate, with a capital H. And she'd go, get in there and play the piano. Get in there and play the piano. Get in. Oh, and I would just throw a fit, and I, you know, until I'd sit down, and then it was a little bit easier than it was the day before. And then it was kind of easy. And then pretty soon, you know, I got to play for friends, and then all of a sudden I was enjoying it. Practice. Practice love. Because it doesn't come naturally. It doesn't. You're going, really? I'm such a lovely person. I think it should just come naturally. It doesn't. Practice it. Practice love. I have to practice love because I cannot love some people. Anybody like me, or am I just talking to all you perfect people? Some people are just not lovely. They're not. And I want to walk up and say, you are not lovely. And I don't like you at all. And then I read the Bible and it says, practice love. Then I try to be nice. Then I pray. Then I see them. And I think, I don't like you. And then I go back and I pray. And this goes on and on and on. Right? And I'm going to tell you something, ladies. It'll go on and on and on until this side of heaven is done. Because we have flesh, which is anti anything God. And so our spirit wars against our flesh back and forth. So what we do is exercise our faith that he is our Lord, practice love, practice, practice, and that gives you perseverance. Let me read to you just in closing now. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13, it says, but we ought to give thanks to Elohim. Isn't that just beautiful? We ought to give thanks to Elohim always for you, beloved by the Master, because Elohim from the beginning chose you to be saved. Set apart ones, filled with the Spirit in the belief in truth, unto which he called you by our good news for obtaining of the esteem of our Master, your Messiah. So then, stand fast. Hold to the traditions which you were taught, whether it's by this word or by letter, and our Master, the Messiah himself, our Elohim, our Father, that has loved us and has given us his everlasting encouragement and good expectations through his favor. Ladies, the Lord gives you good expectations through his favor. Don't you just love that? There is good for you ahead through his favor in your life. And now may the everlasting encouragement and the good expectations through the God's favor encourage your heart, establish you in every good word and work. Establish you in what you're doing for the Lord, in your words and what you're doing for him. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we know, Lord Jesus, you are our Master. You are our Savior. You are the Messiah. You are our Elohim. You are God above all gods. And you have favor towards us. You have goodness towards us. That we have a story to tell to the nations. Like no other story. That you love and you're a God of redemption and a God of kindness. And Father, we pray that we would be those vessels that pour out that love. Father, even if we know someone that's walked away from you, that we would still love that person, Father. And that, Lord Jesus, you would bring them back to where they should be, Lord. And Father, we lift up to you now, Lord Jesus. I lift up to you the tables the ladies are sitting at, Father, where they're going to be sharing their hearts, that they would be able to become transparent with one another. And if they're struggling or they're sad, that they can get prayer before they leave. We thank you that you lift us this word. And that, Lord Jesus, that you are the one, Father, that imparted to Paul to write this, to encourage us thousands of years later. And Father, we love you in your precious name. Amen.
Why don't we all stand and worship? Hi, friends. Again, this is Pastor Gerald from Joshua Springs Calvary Chapel in Yucca Valley, California. I want to share something with you that's very dear to my heart. In Matthew chapter 19, in verse number 13, it says, "Then the little children were brought to him, to Jesus, that he might put his hands on them and pray. But the disciples rebuked them. But Jesus said, 'Let the little children come to me, and do not forbid them, for of such is the kingdom of heaven.'" We've had a Christian school here at Joshua Springs for over 20 years, and I've always loved the fact that we're able to raise up the next generation. Here about a year ago, though, the Lord began laying something on my heart that I've thought about for many years but had never implemented, and we were in the place where we were able to do it. We call it our Matthew 19:14 plan, which is basically this: let the children come. And so as a part of that, we here at Joshua Springs, if you want to enroll your kids in school, you can pay general tuition and there's no other requirements. But if you can't afford Christian education, but you're a wonderful Christian family and you want your kids to have that, the Lord has opened for us a way. The Matthew 19:14, and here's how it works. If you attend Joshua Springs 40 times during the year, if you volunteer during the year 40 hours of service, and that's, you can be an usher, you can help in a classroom, you can teach Sunday school, but if you donate 40 hours of time and you tithe 10%, your kids are able to come to school here with no additional cost outside of book fees. And so as you look at that, I want you to think about it, because even if you live in the Coachella Valley, we have lots of people up here that commute down below to be able to go to work. But I want you to think about it, because you could buy a much nicer house here for a lot less money and have your kids in private education. And so it's something to consider. You know, one of the things that we have to remember, it's a biblical mandate that we raise up our own children in the ways of the Lord. And of all the things that we do as Christian families, there's nothing more important than raising up the next generation. And that begins with our own household. So if you're interested in the Matthew 19:14 program for Joshua Springs Christian School, simply give us a call. Our phone number is 760-365-0769, and we'll be happy to answer your questions. God bless you.
who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Thank you, Jesus. He is perfect in all of his ways. Amen.
This is Audrey Heather with Joshua Springs Calvary Chapel, and I want to thank you so much for being a part of our ministry, and we would like to give you a special gift today. Now, if you want to help support this ministry, you can go to www.joshuasprings.org. Once you're on the JS website, click Simple Give under the Donate tab. Donate any amount to our television radio ministry, and we will send you a copy of our latest Joshua Springs worship album. Once again, we just want to thank you so much for your support of this ministry, and we pray that our ministry and this new worship album will bless you greatly.
There's no place where we can't find peace.